y equals mx plus b, which you should know is the slope intercept, right? The highest power here, even it doesn't say, is 1. When we were asked to look for 2 points at least, right? We were asking for the x-intercept and y-intercept. One way of getting it was to make a little chart, right? And when I set x equal to 0, I think you can see that the y-intercept is b, correct? Mm-hmm. Now when I set y equal to 0, and I want to find this right here, by the way, that is the y-intercept. But 0, when I set y equal to 0, and I solve, so in other words, I have 0 equals mx plus b, right? And I'm trying to solve for x. So I subtract a b, and I have mx. So now I divide by m. So we can see that the x-intercept, in general, in any line, anything that's to the power of 1, is going to be minus b over m. It's like the y-intercept divided by the slope, negative of it. So this is going to be minus b over m. Now, because I didn't put any numbers, I can't really graph it, but in general, if I had a graph, it was capital Y, I mean x. So I don't know where exactly the y-intercept is, but somewhere it would cross the y-intercept at some 0 comma b. And also, too, I don't know exactly where you would have an x-intercept. Well, that x-intercept would be minus b m comma 0. You see? So the line would be something like that. But we don't know. I mean, we don't know. Because it's general, right? So now what I want you to do for the final, I want you to be able to think of the next one up, which is, this is a polynomial, means it has more than one variable, right? It has this variable, and this is a variable, right? But the highest powers are 1. So fundamentally then, the most important theorem in algebra, I don't know if you've ever heard of it, the most important theorem in algebra. Have you?
I can't remember the name.
It's the fundamental theorem of algebra. The fundamental means the most fundamental. No. The most fundamental theorem of algebra. And it says that the highest power of a polynomial is equal to the number of, anybody? Number of what? The highest power of polynomial is the number of what? How many of it must it have? How many y-intercepts does it have? It only has one y-intercept, right?
I'm kidding, I'll fill it out for you.
The highest power of a polynomial, this case, 1, will be equal to the number of x-intercepts. That's pretty cool. So if I have a power of 2, power of 3, that means they're going to have 3 x-intercepts. So the next most general step up from where we're at here, right, would be this, where y equals, let's say, a, x, look, that's the second power, plus b to the x plus c, okay? Notice that what's the highest degree? 2, right? So that means that when you graph it, that this thing will have 2 x-intercepts and 1 y-intercept. This is a parabola. Guess what the next one would look like? It would look like something like this, y equals ax cubed plus bx squared plus cx plus d. That is the most general form in terms of what? What's the highest degree there?
three. So guess how that looks. When that's graphed, it's going to look something like this. Whoops. Well, it could look like that. You see I have three?
You see I have three x-intercepts?
Guess what to the fourth power is going to look like. I'm going to take a U-turn. Fifth power. I'm going to come back down.
Sixth power. I keep getting more and more x-intercepts.
Is that cooler or what?
So what happens if I have it like this, the most general case I can have it? Y equals a x to the n. Nth power of the root plus b times x to the n minus 1. Did you see? I dropped down one more than that one. Plus dot 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 plus, and you finally get to your constant, just your number, your y-intercept. I don't know, I can call it p. That's the very last term. It's always going to be your y-intercept.
You see that if I cover this right here, that's our line, isn't it? With power of 1.
1 x-intercept.
2.
2 x-intercepts.
That is the fundamental theorem of algebra, the most important theorem in algebra. Okay, so now, that's the progression I'm asking you to find the x-intercepts of a second degree polynomial. Now you know what a second degree polynomial is. What's that? There's a lot of that there. Yeah, the highest power. And any questions? Okay, so let's try one. See what I'm telling you what I'm talking about now. The easiest type's gonna be like this. So now I'm gonna go like this. Let me just get rid of it. Okay, now, suppose I have an equation like that, y equals x squared plus 2x minus, let's say, 3. If I cover that up, that's a line. But now this, now how many x-intercepts does that have? How many x-intercepts will I have? 2. Woohoo! You got it. This is a deep concept. You got it. Good. Okay. Here's x. And here's y. Okay, now, if I want to graph it, I do my little, like always, if I don't know if you notice this, but I'm doing this thing over and over and over and over and over and over. And put x equals 0, y equals minus 3. You should know that by now. It's always the y-intercept when x equals 0, right? But we already said how many x-intercepts are there? There are 2, right? So that means, in this case, I'm going to actually have to set 0, y equal to 0 twice. Now I'm going to show you why there are 2 solutions. I know it's exciting. You'll find it super exciting now. What did we do now? Look what happens when I set y equal to 0. What happens? Here we go. I'm going to do it for you so you don't even have to extend your mind. Plus 2x minus 3. Did you see what I did? I'm back to the case where I just set the y equal to 0. Do you see it? Now, how do you expect that I'm going to get the x by itself now? Now it's not so easy, is it? Because it's kind of entwined. You see an x here and x squared here? How do we solve for x by itself? Huh? Somebody tell me, how do we get the x by itself mathematically? We do this, We have to factor. But Mr. Rodriguez, why do we have to factor? We factor. Factoring, you can go out and practice factoring. Why? Because I want you to be able to get the x by itself. We factor to untwine this. Untwine it? I don't know if that's a word. So, you got to know by practice that when you have a minus sign here, you're going to have, you don't care what's in front. That means this sign. You're automatically going to have a plus minus. This is a factor. Okay, now, if you don't have an x and an x, you'll never get back to x squared. Do you agree? Somebody say they agree. So, now how about factors of 3? Well, that happens to be 1 times 3, and notice that the difference is 2, which is our middle term. That's why you have to factor. Why do you have to factor? Because we're trying to solve for the x.
in a two-degree polynomial. Now, so a 3 has to go like here, and a 1 here. How can we test to see if that's correct? How can we check that? How can we say the bottom step is the same as the top step above it? How can we check this? Dilemma? Yes, that's a method gotta move. It's called distribution.
The opposite of factor is distribution.
So voila. Voila. You see, you're a cowboy girl, right? Or cowgirl. Your radio? Rodeo? So if you look at this, it looks kinda like horns, doesn't it? Like a freaky horn, and then, or maybe this is a freaky horn. You see it? So now you will never forget because x times x is two copies of x, correct? And then this is x times minus 1 is minus x, correct? How about this one? What's that? Okay, all at once, 3x. And finally, that's minus 3. You see that? But if I do my banker thing, I spent an x and I deposit 3x. You see, I do have 2x. So, this does equal that. Okay, now, what is this a graph of? You tell me. Just this part. If I were to graph it, let's say that was equal to y. What would that be looking like?
You mean is it like positive?
No, I mean, what would the graph of it look like?
Straight up.
Yeah, what does straight up mean?
Well, because it's just
is it a line, a curve, or what?
It's just a line.
Yeah, a line with a slope what? What's the slope in front of the x?
1.
Yeah, what's the y-intercept?
3.
Yeah, and what's this? It's another line. The slope what? Right. Look what we've done. We've taken this thing, and we split it into the product of two lines. Whoa, that's a trip. Let your mind wrap around that. We've taken a curve and we factored it so it's be a product of two lines. Is that not weird? Is that not interesting? Now, look at my fist. This is the left fist. And this is my right. Let me know when you're done. Okay? Now left and right. Are you watching?
Mm-hmm.
Left times right equals what? Left fist plus right fist equal, just say it, 0. Okay? Now, if this fist times this fist equals 0, what does that say about one of my fists? What must it equal to?
One of them
is 0. It has to be one of these equal to 0, right? At least one. So what's going to happen? Either I'm going to say 0 is equal to x plus 3, or 0 is going to equal to x minus 1. You got it? Good. So if we solve that, what is this? The x-intercept, one of them is equal to what?
1.
Yep. And the other x-intercept?
That's
right. Now guess what? We get to fill this up with let's graph it. What will this look like? Well, we know it has two x-intercepts, right? We're just graphing it roughly, in generalities, but this is, when x is equal to 0, this is minus 3, you see? X is 0, this is minus 3, right here. And then one of these points, when y is equal to 0, x is 1. That's 1, 0. Do you see that? Somebody say they see that. And this one, oh, look at that is. That's minus 3, 0. So what does a graph look like? It has to look like this. It has to come through this point. It has to cross the y-intercept. At some point, it needs to cut up so like this. That is the graph of this. Little trick here to get the x by itself, you see. So we're going to learn factoring. There's lots of tricks, little tricks of factoring. Because it just is.
down.
Is that all to it?
No, there's more.
Why is there more?
Because there are tricks. You got to factor to what?
Why do we do factoring? Why do we do chapter of chapter of factoring? Because eventually, I want you to find these x-intercepts. If this is to the third power, I would have to put another zero here. Find another process by trying to find three factors at least. You understand? Okay, so if I had to the third power,
you have to try to find another way of getting the next intercept.
All right, so let's take it next step a little bit harder. Now, before you factor, obviously, if you had a two factor of two in all of these, you want to factor that out first. You understand that? That's an important point. If I give you a problem that has a, let's say, a four here, and I make that an eight, and I make that a six, you got to see that whatever you can draw out, you draw it out first before you start doing this. Okay. So let's try this. Okay, suppose I have this. Let me just, I'm going to make up a problem here. I'm going to call it 2x minus 1. Let's see what that would come out to be. That would be 2x squared, right? And this one would be minus x, and this would be plus 6x. And this would be minus 3. So this is going to be y equals 2x plus 5x minus 3. Do you see it? No, I got this. This is a plus 5, isn't it? I combined my x's, yeah? I spent 1, but I deposited 6. Okay. Now, why did I do that? I did it because I want to create a next harder problem. I kind of just invented it right now.
So let's see. I want to move on here. Let me get rid of something here. This is always fun. You feel kind of like a dog where you can just wipe things out. Okay.
So what I'm saying now is that we have a different kind of problem. Suppose I give you instead of this. Okay. So suppose I have this problem. Oops. Let me see. I give you this. Why? Equals 2x squared. Oh, I forgot this. Why didn't somebody tell me? 2x squared plus 5x minus 3. So how many x-intercepts or roots, or they call it another word, in roots, will we have? Two, good. Okay, now. If we start with our little table again, I hope you see I'm doing this over and over, and x equals 0, this is minus 3. That is your y-intercept. But because I know I'm going to have 2, I'm going to have to set y equals 0 twice. I'm going to show you why it's actually mathematically the case, but not quite yet. So I look at this, and now I have to try to find, I set y equals 0, yes? So 0 is equal to 2x squared plus 5x. Minus 3. Now this is a bit of a complication because we're used to having a 1 in front of there, like we did last time. If you remember last time, we had y equals x squared plus 2x minus 3. Yeah? See, there was a 1 in front of here. But now, when we have this kind of setup, it's another trick. What's it mean when there's a minus in the back? What does that mean about our factors? It's going to have a what and a what?
Plus and
a minus. You don't care. If there's a minus in there, it's automatically plus minus. If it's a plus, you have to duplicate this sign. If it were a plus, it'd be plus plus.
Or if it was a minus, it'd be minus minus. Right. The rule is, if there's a plus in the back, you duplicate the sign in front. If it's a minus, you don't care what's in front. It's always plus minus. You hear what I said? Did it make sense? Well, you know I'm going to have an x here, right, and an x here, because I'll never get back to the x squared. However, now I have to look at factors of not just 3. Do you remember before here? 1 times 3 and the difference is 2. That worked out pretty nicely. Here it's a little trickier. I have to take factors of 2 and factors of 3 and come up with a middle term of 5, right? So I can see that, what's 2 times 1? That's 2, yeah? And 1 times 3? And guess what? That adds to 5. It's not always that way. It's lucky. It's a trick of factoring. In this case, it's still nice to us. So I have to use a 1 and a 1, right? So I would use a 1 here, right, and a 1 here, of course. Actually I would have 2, right? So let me put a 2 here. The 1 I don't even really need, but anyway, I got to have a 2 and a 1. Now I have to have a 3 and a 1. So I have a 3 and a 1, and then I use the 2 and a 1, I think. So let me test it. So x times x is 2x squared, yes? Let me see that. That was this. And this would be minus an x, true? And this would be a 6x, yeah? And this would be a minus 3, you see? So it actually does equal 2x plus 5x, okay? You see that it does? It's not too pretty looking, but this does equal 2 back here again. Okay, so what does that say? It says that 0 is equal to x plus 3, or 0 is equal to 2x minus 1. You see that? Because now I got it factors of 2 lines. So if I solve this, this is x-intercept going to be equal to minus 3, right? And this one here is going to be, or I'm going to add 1 and divide by 2. Is this okay? So, what do I got here? Well, in one case I have, what, a half? And I also have a minus 3 as x-intercepts, true? What would that look like? Well, this is the y and the x. Capital. And over here I have, when x equals 0, I still have a minus 3. But here I have 0 is 1, it'd be a half. This is like 0 comma, no. So this would be like a half comma 0. And this would be minus 3 comma 0. What's it look like? Well, it's going to be steep, but it has to come down like this, go down a ways and come back up some point. Doesn't look too good, but you get the idea. Let's try it. This equation right here, 2, 5x minus 3. Now, let's take a look at this and see what it looks like online. Okay, so if I go here, okay, and right here, I'm going to have what I had before, y equals, right, x squared, right? Actually, it was 2x, wasn't it? Is that right? Mm-hmm. And then what was it, plus 5x? And then we have minus, was it 3?
Yeah, minus 3. Yeah.
Okay. Let's take a look at the graph. Oh, what is this? Yes, a half. What is this?
anybody have an idea how you might find out what the
lowest point is of this function?
How can you find the lowest y value? Any ideas? You know what I mean by the lowest y value? How can we find this point?
Just out of curiosity. The lowest point is minus
6.2. Minus 6.125, right? And what is the x value associated with that? Minus 1.25. I'm asking you, how can you find that minus 6.125, given that you have your two x-intercepts? Look at it. What can you see about the middle point? Well, there's some symmetry here, right? There's a line of symmetry. You see it going straight up? So, if I know the distance from here to here, I'm talking on the x, right? Here's a half. Here's 3. So the midpoint would be what? Well, actually, the midpoint's going to be between... Well, if you take from minus 3 and you walk over to here is 3, and you walk over another half step, right? Total distance is 3.5. What's half of 3?
1.
No. Well, what's half of a half?
Half of 0.5. So the answer's going to be... You know, the midpoint would be, we would count over 1.5, right? You understand what I'm saying? Taking half of this distance. And you either add it to this side, like if you add 1 1/4, you see where you end up. And I'm just saying, if you know that this thing is symmetrical, that means that right in the middle, you have this much space is the same as this much space. If you take that value of x, right, guess what it's going to be? You see that? Now what are you going to do with that 1.25? You're going to stick it into your equation. You see if you put in minus 1.25 in here, and you square it, and then take 5 times the square root, you're going to get y. Guess what y value did? There it is, 6.
So you can actually find the low point or the high point by finding the midpoint between the two x-intercepts. Anybody understand that?
Okay. And now? Okay, let's go back then. Alright. So it does kind of look like that in a way. A rough view of it.
Okay, now. Next step. I'm taking you to the next harder step. I call it harder. It's not really harder, but it's only because you have to know the steps before to make it harder.
But supposing that this was a number other than 3, such that your little trick here won't work. So the question is, what do you do when it's not nice, when it's not friendly, when it doesn't factor easily? Then what do we do? Okay, we'll go to the big boy, big girl stuff. And now, I say, we have a case. Now, suppose I have the same kind of y equals 2x plus 3x, let's say, minus, say, 5. So let me look at factors of 2. That's 1 times 2 and 1 times 5. That's 1 times 5. So, I can't, well, here it is, 1 times 2, 1 times 5, that's 2 and that's 5, that would subtract a 3, so maybe that's not what I want, it's not a good example, it looks like it would work. Well, let me try this. So let's try this one at, try 4.
factors of 4. Well, factors of 2 are 1 times 2. But 4 is 1 times 4 and 2 times 2. Now I'm trying to get a way that we could get a 3 as a middle term. Well, if I went 2 times 2, that's 4. And then I went 1 times 2, that's 2. That subtracts 2. 2, that doesn't work. I could take 4 times 4 times 1, which is 4, and then try to take 2 times 1. But that subtracts the 2, not, there's no middle term of 3. Well, what do we need? We need another system, because it's not working. How do we do it? We do it by what you'll need to do on the final, is you have to complete the square. This will force you to get the really, will force it so that you will get the right answer. So first of all, this is not working, our normal. And there's nothing to factor out here, right? Because 2 is not in common here, or 3. There's no common term. So there's nothing much we can do there. But we can still try. So when we do our little chart, which you see, I go over and over again. I got a little x and a little y. Obviously, when x equals 0, y is equal to minus 4. And because of the fundamental theorem of algebra, I know I'll have to set y twice, right? So now I have to try to figure out how to do it. And since it's not easy, I'm going to have to complete the square. How do you complete the square? Okay. Let's complete the square with the easier one first. So I'm going to come back to my original one. Do you remember x squared plus 2x minus 3? You do remember that there was a way to factor that, right? Factor was like 1, 2, 1, 3. Mm-hmm. Right? Do you remember that? But let's suppose I don't know the trick, I don't see it, so I'm going to complete the square. So the first thing is, of course, you set the y equal to 0, right? X squared plus 2x minus 3, right? Because we're looking for x-intercepts, so we set the y equal to 0. You bring the constant over, did you see? I added 3 to both sides. So now I have x squared plus 2x. Okay, this is how you complete the square. And always you're going to take this middle term, the 2, and you're going to divide by 2. Okay? You're going to take that answer, and you're going to square it. You're going to take it to the second power. Square it. And you're going to add it. So watch. What is 2 divided by 2?
1.
And what's 1 squared?
1.
Yeah. So because I add it there, I have to add it here. It's still 1, though. But however, this over here now is 4. Do you see that? And because we completed the square, this will always factor. What do you do when there's a plus in the second position? You duplicate the sign in front. I know it's hard, it's like two rules to remember there. So we have x and x, right? And 1 and 1. Look, what's x times x? X squared. X, there's one x. Here's another x to make 2x. You see that? And that equals 4. Now, this is the same. We can make it look pretty. Let me change the sides and swap it over. So I'm going to bring this over here. However, I see that I have two copies of one of these. Look, I have two copies of one of these. That's the pretty way of putting it. It's still equal to 4, right? I just changed, swap. Put that first and the 4 back. Okay, now, this is what you got to know, that how do I get the x by itself? You square root it. She's right. In order to get rid of this, we have to know the square root. And to do the square root, you have to know what the square root means.
it's so common to use the square root that we don't put it, but it's there, a little 2. So that, the square root of x is equal to x to the 1/2 power. The cube root, or the cube root, would be x to the 1/3 power. And so on, to the nth root, would be equal to x raised to the 1 over n. Now, I want to show you that this will always, anytime you take an actual square root of something that's squared, you'll have two answers. Look, suppose I have x squared equals 9, right? And I'd like to square root it, let's say like that. Okay, so what does this square root mean? It means x squared raised to the 1/2 power equals 9. That's what it means. Now, notice that x could be 3, right? Because what's 3 squared? Oops. Actually, I want to change this. It's not 9, is it? Yeah. 3 squared is 9, but if I want this to be, I'm going to put this to 3. Okay, so x could be 3, right? Because what's 3 squared? 9. What's the square root of 3? What's the square root of 9?
3.
Yeah. So x can also be equal to minus 3, right? Because minus 3 is 9 again. And it works. So anytime, the rule is anytime you take the square root of a square root of a square, there'll be two solutions. Which is a good thing, because I need to. Okay? So to get x here, I'm going to do what? I'm going to square root it, like she said. Here and here. And I know that this answer is going to be 2, right? But I'm going to remind me that there could be two solutions of 2, a plus and a minus. And this is raised to the 1/2 power, right? So I can rewrite this as x plus 1 squared, all that raised to the 1/2 power. You see that? Now, you know that if I have x squared raised to the 1/3 power, what does that tell me? It tells me, starting from up here, that I have 3 packages of this. You see it? And what does that mean? That means in total I have 6 copies. What, right? So what's the shortcut? The shortcut is power to the power. It multiplies. So that when you have power of A raised to the power of B, the answer will be x of A times B. Do you see that? Do not confuse that with you have 3 copies here plus 2 copies here. Notice that you have 3 copies and then 2 more. Right? For a total of 5 copies, right? What did we do? We didn't multiply, we added. So when you have x to the a plus x to the b, that's going to be equal to x to the a plus b. See how it's different than power to the power? So what do you think 1/2 times 2 is? What's 1/2 of 2?
1.
Yeah, so it gives me just 1 power. So that undoes the square root, right? So what do I have? X plus 1 equals plus and minus 2. I'm going to subtract 1 from it. So x equals minus 1 plus and minus 2. You see that? But what are the two solutions? One x-intercept, you have to go the high road. Minus 1 plus 2 is equal to 1. How about the low road? X-intercept is minus 1 minus 2, which is equal to minus 3. If you look at your notes, we have the same answers, but it was easier because we found a trick. But I'm showing you how to complete the square when there's no trick available, which would carry to have 1 minus 3. Okay, I used to complete the square even though I knew there was a trick. I'm showing you that to come to the same answer. Is that too deep or is that deep enough? If it's too deep, you start cracking. You can see your head. You start texting.
But if you're involved, you're like, wow.
Okay, now, I'm going to do the same thing then, but I'm going to do one where I know there's no trick. Okay, this is final material in my book.
And so I'm going to go back over to here. And now I'm going to show you the one that we worked on before, I think was y equals 2x squared plus, what was it, 3x minus, I forgot, what did we do before, was it 5x?
What was the one we did before?
4. Four? Here? Okay, let's see if it's true. Are there any factors of 2? 1 times 2? Yeah, you're right. 1 times 2 and 2 times 2. I couldn't find any factors that add up to 3 or subtract to 3. Wait a minute. Let's see. This one did. 2 times 2 is 4, and 1 times 1. It's 3.
That's not the problem. What was it?
What was the last problem we did before this?
I don't think we...
You have to put a 5 first, and then it still goes to
the 2. Add what?
You have to put a 5 back there before it's...
Okay, that's what I mean.
Alright, so this doesn't look too good.
Okay, so it was a 5. All right, so when we looked at this, and I looked for factors of 4 and 2, and see if they add up to 5. I don't think they do. It doesn't really matter. But here's 1 times 2. And this is 1 times 4 and 2 times 2. Those are prime numbers. So I can't see anywhere where we got, you know, 2 times 2 is 4, 2 times 1 is 6, 4 times 2 is 8, minus 1 is 7. I don't see it. I don't know if anybody sees it, but can't get any of these terms to come up with 5 as a middle term. Okay. And there's no way around this kind of thing without you practicing it, because you got this, they're going to give you a lot of this stuff, and they want you to factor it out. So if we can't do it that way, if we can't solve it with a trick, how do we solve it? By what method? Completing the square. That's one of those tough ones. Okay. Now, I'm going to compute the square now, but what's different from the problem before? Remember, I had just a 1 here, and now I have a 2. All right? So, I'm going to set, well, I'm going to do again, over and over and over. I could be a robot, just doing the same thing, put in 0, always get your y-intercept up on that, at least 100 times, I would say. Maybe not. 99. But, then I know I'm going to have, by the fundamental theorem of algebra, yeah. So I'm going to set 0 equal to 2x, just like I did before. Okay? Now, this is what you have to do, though. And this is going to look a little weird. But before you complete the square, did you see what I'm saying? Before you complete the square, you have to make... You have to put a 1 in here instead of the 2. That's the trick. So look what I'm going to do. I'm going to force factor out a 2. So this is going to be x squared. And in order to factor out this, I have to make 5 over 2. You see that? Plus 4 over 2. Did you see? That will work, because this times that is 2x squared. And this times here, notice the 2's will divide out. And this times 2, notice
the 2 to divide out.
Did you see I forced a 2 out? I forced a 2 out.
It didn't want to, but in order to fall 2 out, I had to put this under 2. Is there any questions, sir?
Did you see how I forced it out?
You sure?
Okay. So, the next thing I do,
because I got a 0 here, I'm going to get rid of this pesky 2.
And I think you can see that this is equal to 2, right?
So what I have here is 0 equals 2 x squared plus 5 half x plus 2.
Now I'm back to where I was with the other problem because I only have a 1 in front of the exponents. Okay? So let me say okay. So I'm going to take this number and now bring it over. What do I got? Somebody tell me how do I, what's the next step in completing the square?
Divide by 2.
Divide what by 2? That's kind of a broad general question. Divide what by 2?
Yes, you take this middle term and divide it by 2. So you have to take 5 halves and divide that by 2, which is, you can put that over 1.
How do we do that? Kind of problem?
All right, y'all got it at once. You whip it. And then you flip it. And that's 1 over 2, right? And guess what that is? You go skiing. That's 5/4. What do I do with that 5/4? Yes, I add it on. But I don't just add it on. What do I have to do? You're right. I have to square it. I took the middle term, I divided by 2, I now add it.
Oh, that's what we're looking for. Well, you get the idea? Because I did it there, I have to do it here. You see it?
Let me tell me they see that. You okay? I did it on one side and I did it on the other. Now, what is this equal to? What's 4 squared. Well, that means 2 copies of what? Cha-ching. And how do we multiply it? Just straight across, right? You agree? So that's what this means. So this side here is going to be 25/16 minus 2 is equal to, now this is going to work out perfect because we made it so that we duplicate the sign in front. See? That's an x here and an x here, and duplicate the sign in front, plus plus. And we have to get a 5/4 back. And a 5/4 here. Now, you can check it. X times x is x squared. And this is a 5/4 x plus another 5/4 x. What do we have? We have 5/4 x plus 5x over 4, twice, right? We add it. Guess what? We have a common denominator, don't we? Yes? We do. And up here we have, is that 10x? Yeah. So I'm just adding them up now. So guess what that equals to?
5/2. So it does get back to where we were.
It has to because we divide it by 2. So when you add it twice, you understand? Does anybody understand what I'm doing?
Yeah.
That's good to know. It's called feedback. Okay, so now,
can I make this pretty? I can make this pretty. Why? Because I got 2 copies of 1. So instead of writing 2 copies, I'm going to write it as, and I'm going to make 2 copies of 1 of them. Okay?
Somebody say yeah. Let me do it like this.
Yeah.
No. No. That's good. I think you have to do some kind of witch dance. It's not bad. Okay. Now, guess what this equals to? This equals to this. So I'm over here on the side, I'm going to say 25, you know, 16ths minus 2 over 1, right? And how do I subtract? Well, I subtract by using the nose, yes? So this is 16 here, right? And this is 25 minus 32. Do you see that? Somebody say they see that.
Mm-hmm.
So what's the answer?
I'm having issues.
Okay, so. Yeah? Huh? Not 7. It's 7, but not positive 7. Negative 7/16. You see that? This right here. Okay. I don't know what to tell you, but yeah. Minus 2. Okay. And this is, guess what? It's equal to minus 7/16. Okay. So guess what I'm going to do? I'm going to take the square root. And the square root. So, two copies come out, and it'll be just 1/2 power to the 2 is this, right? This is, yes? And over here, I have to be careful because I have the square root of plus and minus. See, I have two solutions. Plus and minus, minus 7 over 16. So now I'm going to bring this over. I'm going to subtract 5/4 from both sides. So the answer is going to be equal to, let's see, I'm going to use this one. The answer is going to be, I'm going to subtract 5/4. So the x-intercept are going to be equal to minus 5/4 plus or minus the square root of minus 7 over 16. Now remember what half power is. A half power is, you know, it can be what? Distributed. So that I can write this x-intercept as minus 5/4. And I can write that as plus and minus the square root of minus 7 over the square root of 16. But you know that the square root of 16 is 4, correct? Somebody say yeah. So what I got now is my x-intercepts, there are two solutions. One's going to be minus 5/4 plus minus 7, square root of 7i over 4. Right, which can be written as 5 plus the square root of minus 7 over 4. Right? The other one would be the x-intercept would equal to be minus 5/4. But now I would subtract, right, the square root of 7 over 4. Or I would have 5 minus a minus. Okay? So that's kind of interesting. These are supposed to be the two x-intercepts. Now, it's a little weird because we have a negative in here. I'm not sure. We didn't do complex numbers, did we? Did we? Okay, this is equal to the square root of 7 times the square root of minus 1 over 4. See, I just split it up. Because we don't really know what negative square root means. And this one's going to be what? 5 minus the square root of 7 times the square root of minus 1 over 4. Yeah? Now, the definition of a square root of a minus 1 is the letter I. It means it's the imaginary part of a complex number. So if this is the case, then the answer will be equal to 5 plus the square root of 7i over 4. And the other one would be 5 minus 7i, square root of 7i. You probably don't know this yet, I don't know. You've seen it before, haven't you?
The square root of negative 1 is I. This one, I don't know, unless I made a mistake here. I took out a 2. Okay, so here we are again.
Starting from here, I factored out the 2. That's correct. Then I divided by 2. So I'm down to here. Then I bring the minus 2 over here. Then I take half of this, which is 5/4. Square it and I add it to here.
Then I have, remember I subtracted this 2. So 25/16 is less than 2. So I'm getting a negative answer. But I don't understand, let's see. If this has a y-intercept of minus 4, it should have some x-intercepts that are real, not imaginary. Let's see what's going on here. Oh, I know why. I screwed up. Okay. All right. Well, that's a nice experience, but it's wrong. Let me show you what I'm going to stick out here.
No, that's correct, right? I think that added to, yeah, well, that's all right. No. Okay, let's see. Wait, it's not right. There's somebody tell me. I have to catch all this. This is not a bus. Is it? Is it? Look. It's supposed to be minus. You see it? Now, that means that's 2, right? So when I bring the 2 over here, guess what? It's plus 2, right? Because this is, does everybody see that this is minus? Or do you need me to step back? See, it was minus 4. When I factored out the 2, I should have left this minus here and put a plus. Is everybody going to tell? No? Okay, so that makes this a plus 2, doesn't it? Somebody say yeah. No?
Yeah.
Okay. So let's start with that. Now I don't have to worry about this imaginary term because I'm in less than 1. I know it's a problem, see, because we're dipping down below. That means we're going y-intercepts below the x-intercept, right? And it's opening up. But what does that mean? That means it has to have x-intercepts. It's going to cross the x-intercept, but not in the complex plane. The complex plane is in another dimension, believe it or not. It's in the complex plane. It's still second dimension, but it's in another plane. So let's just go back over here. What do I have? You know, I have to get a common denominator, don't I? So I have 25 over 16. Plus 2 over 1, what do? I go, right? And here I have 16, 25. Now, instead of subtract, I have plus 32. Aha! What do we have? 57 sixteenths? What's 5 plus 7? No, that won't work. 5 plus 7 is 12. Yeah. So let's see, 3 will, but 3 won't go into 16. So I don't know if they have a common term or not. Let's see. Okay. Anyway, so what does that mean?
That means that now I can write this side over here as 57 over 16 equals two copies of what? X plus 5/4 squared, yeah. Of which, what I have to do is take the square root, correct? I'm going to take the square root of this and the square root of this. Okay, this can be written as, like, because it's multiplication, I can write it as the square root of 57 over the square root of 16. And this, remember that they're going to be two solutions, plus minus, because I've taken the square root of the square. So that's going to be equal x to 5/4. So I can solve now for my x-intercept how? By subtracting 5/4 from both sides. So I have minus 5/4, yes? You see it? I brought it over to this side. Then I have plus and minus the square root of 57 over the square root of 16, which is what?
4.
Yeah, so I got a common denominator. So my two solutions for my x-intercept will be minus 5 plus the square root of 57 and over 4, or x-intercept is going to be equal to minus 5 minus the square root of 57 over 4. Okay, now, if you want to graph it, what is the square root of 57? Let's see, what's the square root of, the square root of 64? You agree that's 8? Somebody say they agree. What about the square root of 49?
7.
So guess what, I know the answer lies between here and here.
7.
And I kind of look to see where it's closer. Is it closer to the 64 or 49? Yeah, so probably, what, something like 7.6, I don't know. You can look, if you have a calculator, you can try it now. Of course, it's going to go forever because it's, you know, irrational number. So do you have anybody have a calculator?
Okay.
What is the square root of 57? It can't be too far off. Maybe 7.7.
7.549834435270755.
That's as far as my calculator. Okay, 7.549. 7.549. 54. Yeah, it's pretty close. It was just an estimate. So, what would my x-intercept be? My x-intercept b is going to be equal to, look, it's going to be equal to minus 5 plus 7 point, let's just call it 7.5 over 4. Well, what is that? That's going to be, you spent 5, but you deposited 7, so one answer is going to be equal to, right, 2.5 over 4, right? What is 2.5 divided by 4? Well, it's like 250, right? So how many? So there goes 8.
And you have about 8
M. Let's see, 4 goes into what? 8? 4 times 8 would be, that's too big.
Let's see, what was it?
4 goes into 7, 4 times 6, 6 times 6 something.
Was it 2.5?
It's 2.5 divided by 4. And the other one's going to be
0.625. So
0.625. Okay, and this one's going to be equal to, you see? Minus 5 minus 7.5. So you're going to have what? 3 minus 12.5?
Yeah.
Divided by 4. So a little bit bigger than 3. Ain't it? What is that? Well, I know 4 goes in there 3, and 3 goes in there 4 goes in there 1. What is it? 3.1? What?
12.5
divided by 4. I think that would be
maybe
3.5. Minus?
12.5.
It goes in 3 times. That's 3.1. 3.1? So roughly negative 3.1. Okay, So what would our graph look like? You can see it's a little harder when it doesn't break down easier. You have to complete the square. But what does that look like? That's going to look like this, the graph of it. Okay. Okay, so what's the y, the y and the x, right? And then we have the intercept. Well, we know that this y-intercept is minus 4, right? When x equals 0, this was common minus 4. This is x, this is a minus. Okay, and the other one was when y equals 0, that was equal to 6.25. So that's about right here. That would have been, now you have x equals to y equals to 0. And this is going to be 0.625 comma 0. And the other one's going to be minus 3.1. Something about here where it's going to be minus 3.1 comma 0. Okay, so what would that look like? Well, if we did it correctly, we have one x-intercept goes like this at some point, and bends up like that. It's kind of shifted over. So if somebody will remember this equation, we'll try it.
It goes 2, 5, and 4. So let's try it.
Let's see. Okay. So this was 2, 5, and then this was 4, wasn't it? Yeah?
That's 5x.
5x minus 4? Or 4x?
It's 5, right?
So what am I going to do here? I'm going to add 4? It's minus 4?
Yeah.
Okay. Let's take a look. Now, this would probably be more accurate. Okay, but right here, one root was what? 0.637. Which we have, what, roughly 0.625. You see that? And this one was equal to minus
3.1.
Pretty close, right? And of course, the y-intercept, you know, 4. Okay. So, do you think you can complete the square now?
Yes.
Okay, now. Say 2.2x minus pi. Okay. I want you to complete the square. I'm pretty sure there's no tricks with pi. You end up with it, you know. I know that for sure. But we know pi is around 3.14 something, right? So I want you to do the little chart. So when x equals 0, what's y?
Well, it's x equals 0 is just pi.
Minus pi.
Is pi, yeah.
Okay, now, by the fundamental theorem of algebra, I want to set this guy equal to 0, right? Whoops. Now, you can't just take the middle term. First, you have to factor out that 4. Does everybody remember that?
that, so.
Okay, so try it on some paper and see if you got it.
You can give it to me, and you'll be happy.
So, let's see.
Put that 4 in, divide it out, right?
Huh?
Put that 4.
You have to pull it out first.
Yeah.
And then divide by 4. Let's see. See what x intercept you come up with. Thank you.